third on the left side of the lane. Goes to baseline. Puts up in close. He got a fish. Over one up the can. The great Larry Finch to start for the Tigers.
Keenan on the high post. Keenan for a 15-footer and Keenan got it.
Larry Keenan.
Climbed down the left side of the lane. Finch fires to 16 feet. Thanks to that. Larry Finch is scoring again. Near side. The pivot to Robinson. Baseline jumper to 17 feet. Bingo. Robinson got it. Ronnie's second shot. And the end of the night. We're tied at 39.
People ask, how was that Memphis State team able to shock the basketball world and advance to the 1973 National Championship game? Well, I'm here to tell you, it took a lot of ingredients. A whole lot of ingredients. It all started with 2 tablespoons of orange mallow. One, a 6'2 guard with a leaning jump shot. The other, a forward, quick, like a big cat. Add 3 tall stalks from junior college, Billy Bip, Wes Westfall, and Dr. K. Take a dash of freshman and a pinch of Bartow's Bandits. Mix in a scrappy point guard with a hot hand, a cool head, and a whole lot of money. All these ingredients, when stirred and cooked by Gene Bartow, one of the finest chefs in the game, combined to make a team that was unbeatable. Well, almost unbeatable.
Rightly seasoned, the 1973 Memphis State Tigers, brought to you by Ford, First Tennessee Bank, and the University of Memphis Alumni Association.
If I can go back all the way to 1968, you remember that was the time when Dr. King was killed here in the city. And from that time until 1972, there was a real rift between the two races in this community. There's no question about it.
Hard times. I remember the incident that happened down on Beale Street with all the riots and everything. And just sitting there as a kid watching that, I couldn't believe what was going on.
When I first told my mother that I was going to go down there, she didn't want me to go.
I know when I first got there, you know what I mean, I was kind of scared. You know what I mean? Living in the place where Dr. Martin Luther King had gotten killed.
The only thing that, in my judgment, keeping the city going was efforts on behalf of some of the leadership of both races to try to do everything they could to alleviate the situation. Well, as hard as they worked, nothing much was happening until the 1972-1973 basketball season in Memphis State.
It was the first time, to my knowledge, in the city of Memphis that they had that many African Americans on the same basketball team. And I think that we had become Memphis's team.
It really brought the two communities together because it was just a good feeling, and as a player and being a part of it, you felt proud that you had something to do with that.
That team was something that everybody could get behind, and in my mind, all of the past in 1968-73, in March of 1973, dropped away and we're back to one city. And that team did the job.
It unified the city, black, white, young, old. People forgot about the racial disharmony and all of that. It was just an exciting time for the city.
The healing of a city divided began in Orange Mound at Melrose High School. Larry Finch grew up on nearby Select Street, where he spent most afternoons working on his trademark jumper.
Growing up in Orange Mound, he built his life just off around basketball, because that was just his first love.
It was at Melrose that he met his best friend and longtime teammate, Ronnie Robinson.
Right here.
Right here.
It all started right here.
Both were devoted to their families and model citizens. Finch could have signed with almost any school in the country. Ironically, like most talented high schoolers of his day, he wanted to go to UCLA.
That's where I wanted to go, to be honest with you. But they didn't know anything about Larry Finch. Larry Finch didn't know anything about L.A.
But Larry decided to stay close to home, to be near his family, and play for Memphis State. But it wasn't a popular decision with the folks in Orange Mound.
It wasn't a popular decision, not only in the Orange Mound community, but throughout the black community in Memphis, because, you know, there were some differences in the city at that time.
And then a lot of people in East Memphis didn't want me out in the first place because I was a young black guy from Memphis.
To tell you how unpopular the decision was, his high school coach refused to show up at his signing, which was Coach William Collins, Brooke Collins. I mean, Coach Collins did not show up at Larry's signing. Verdi Sale was the assistant coach. Verdi Sale was at the signing at the University Center.
I said, well, if you go and do what you're supposed to do, the fans who are not with you now, they'll jump on the bandwagon.
The only thing left for Larry to do was sell former Memphis State coach Mo Iba on Ronnie, who, despite a tall frame and a long wingspan, was considered too thin to play big-time college basketball.
Yeah, I was thin. I was real thin. I was about 6'8", about 172, 182, soaking wet.
Coach Mo Iba was talking about, he said, there's another skinny kid on that team who I think is going to turn out to be one heck of a basketball player, and that was Ronnie Robinson.
Mo Iba kind of looked at me. I guess he probably said, well, I guess the only way we can get Larry is to bring Ronnie with him.
And to make a long story short, they took the gamble and took both of us.
The gamble more than paid off. They teamed up to put Memphis Athletics back in the national spotlight. But more importantly, gave a beleaguered city a reason to unite.
The people in Orange Mound kind of stick together when it comes to their own.
When they went to college, all of us had gone. It wasn't just them going to college. We all went to college.
There was a lot of pride from that community, as well as the people that had been, you know, actually following the Memphis team for many, many years.
Well, people loved them. I mean, they were just great sports heroes for this city.
Phyllis Massey captured their celebrity status in a number of pictures she took while employed as a university photographer.
Anyone who saw them wanted to get to know them, wanted to get their autographs, wanted to talk to them.
It really did a lot for kids in the city because a lot of kids decided they wanted to be basketball players, and they wanted to be like Laugh, and they wanted to be like Ronnie.
All of a sudden, they were the kings of the city, and they should have been because they had done something that nobody else had ever done.
Larry and Ronnie were putting the Memphis State basketball back on the map. It was a transformation that had not been seen in Memphis State sports before.
I'm Glenn Crutchfield of Dobbs Ford. Your Memphis area Ford dealers are proud to honor the 1973 Memphis State basketball team. This team truly brought the city together to cheer the underdog Tigers on to the national championship game. And now, 30 years later, the Memphis Ford dealer community remembers with pride this historic run, which put the city of Memphis on the national sports map. And we're proud to join in the celebration of this remarkable achievement.
In the spring of 1903, Henry Ford made the automobile affordable for everyone. The same holds true today, especially now during Ford's Centennial Celebration Savings Event. Get $3,000 cash back on Ford Expedition, plus returning Ford lessees get an additional $1,500 cash back. That's up to $4,500 cash back on the 2003 Expedition. That's right, the best deal ever on Expedition, up to $4,500 cash back. See your local Ford dealer today.
The University of Memphis Alumni Association brings the more than 100,000 alumni of the U of M together to build relationships, honor faculty, and help prospective students. Each year, the Alumni Association sponsors scholarships and gives awards to professors, researchers, and advisors who make a difference. If you're an alum of the university, please help us by joining the Alumni Association.
Grab your Kroger Plus card and get to Kroger, because it's meat madness. Right now in the Kroger meat department, USDA Choice semi-boneless aged whole ribeye is just $3.99 a pound. Nash low-salt shank half ham is just 79 cents a pound. Kroger boneless skinless chicken breasts are only $1.69 a pound. And frozen tiger shrimp are just $2.99 a pound. But hurry, meat madness ends Tuesday, March 11th, only at Kroger.
I'm Charles Burkett, president of First Tennessee Bank. The 1973 Memphis State basketball team showed an entire community what can happen when people come together and work toward a common goal. I was a student at the university in 1973 and saw firsthand what they were able to become. They motivated us and laid a foundation for great things at the university and in Memphis. On behalf of First Tennessee Bank, I'd like to congratulate the team on its 30th anniversary and thank them for all they did.
This portion of Rightly Seasoned is brought to you by Ford.
The 1972-73 Tigers were indeed rightly seasoned. A perfect blend of experience and youth. They had guards who could shoot, big men who could rebound, and plenty of depth on the bench.
Larry Finch was one of the most charismatic players we ever had.
He was a leader on the floor and off the floor.
Well, I'd heard about him. I knew he was a very outstanding player. He had the quality that I like. He's very quick.
One of the things that made him so great, he could shoot.
Larry could shoot the ball, man.
There's games when he would just absolutely, wherever he shot, it went in.
I was in the game probably professionally and college for, 15 years. Larry Finch is absolutely the greatest pure shooter that I've ever encountered.
He could fill it up.
He's the best shooter I've ever seen.
I can remember one night we was playing somebody in the Coliseum, and he banked one from 30 and called it. And then he was so hot, he went to the other side and called it and looked the guy in the eye and said, I'm going to bank this one too. And I don't think anybody else took a shot that night.
You know, there wasn't a shot Larry didn't like to take.
He never passed. Larry never passed the ball, man. I'm going to tell you that.
I can show you the tape where I pass the
number
ball.
One, back to Finch down the right wing. Keenan in the high post. Keenan for a 15.
Larry missed.
Got it.
For one thing.
And when he did miss him, that's when you had your chance to get yours, because any other time you weren't going to get to it.
Oh, I hated him. He was tough. He made some of the hardest shots I've ever seen, and he'd always jump into you. And I kept telling the officials that's a charge. He can't, he has to go straight up and come straight down. They never called it.
I had to guard him a couple times down the court, and it was no fun.
No, he was a great player, tough, hard-nosed competitor.
He was the kind of guy that when the game was on the line, he was at his best.
He was just fantastic.
Playing alongside Larry Finch as a college player was a real pleasure for me.
And when they write the history of Memphis, Larry Finch will be in the top three or four, no question about it.
He was the most fearsome great rebounder I've ever known. But when that ball came off the board, he flat went. He had 28 rebounds one game. I think it was against Tulsa.
Great defensive rebounder, great offensive rebounder.
Great rebounder, and good instincts and good timing.
A good touch around the basket, come out on the floor 10, 12, 15 feet, hit the jump shot.
The first day I stepped on the floor, he kicked me under the chin here, and I got like 6 or 8 stitches. I learned to stay out from under the big boards real quick.
Ronnie would get in there and get fired up in practice and not mean to hurt you, but that's how he played. And then once, if he hit you or whatever in the head or something like that, or blowed your nose, he'd apologize,
Ronnie Robinson, he's one of the greatest fundamentally sound big men I've ever seen before in my life.
Ronnie was an excellent basketball player and a very good person. He was awesome.
Memphis was Ronnie and Larry's town, and we were outsiders.
When we first got there, believe me, it was from a lovely event with all these junior college guys.
Larry Keenan, Billy Buford, and Wes Westfall were junior college All-Americans. Amid much hype, they arrived on campus in September of 1972. Ronnie Robinson wanted to see firsthand what the excitement was all about, inviting Keenan to an afternoon pickup game.
We all stayed in the dorm. He'd come in and say, "Well, why don't you come out and play?" I said, "No, I really don't want to play."
Yeah, I thought he was a wimp when I first met him.
I remember at practice, you know, everybody's trying to feel everybody out. And Ronnie had roughed Keenan up pretty rough in practice that day.
When we started playing ball, we just got into it, you know, just bumping and knocking each other around.
You know, it was time for Keenan to establish himself. And we had a two-on-three, three-on-two, you know, workout. He came down on the break, and he left maybe two steps inside the free throw line. And he took Ronnie to the meal. I was going, yeah, you know what I mean?
I said, "Hey, this guy gonna be pretty tough."
He gained his respect.
He was just absolutely in a class by himself.
Larry Keenan was a great basketball player. Well, the very first time I saw Larry Keenan, he walked on the floor in the practice gym there. He walks up on the floor, but he picks up one ball in one hand and one ball in the other hand, hasn't said a word to one person on the floor. He walks up to the basket, he takes it and dunks it one hand and this hand in the same motion, and at that point I knew we had a great player on our team.
Keenan was very shy at that time.
People used to think he was strange because he didn't talk. Larry just kept to himself.
He would let me interview him.
He just quietly went about his business.
He let his basketball do his talking.
20 points, 15 rebounds every night, regardless.
He averaged way over a double-double.
The more the season went, the better he got. And the higher the level of competition, he just stepped up and got higher with it.
Yeah, I believe he scored about 20 points against Bill. I knew he was pretty good, but I didn't think he was going to score 20 points against Bill.
Larry Keenan is a terrific basketball player. And an outstanding human being off the court as well.
Larry King is probably the best all-around big guy I ever played with.
I would say besides Bill Walton, Larry Keenan was the best player in college that I watched.
It was a pleasure and a privilege and a thrill to play against someone that good.
Yo, come on now.
Tough. Larry was tough. He was a tough little guy.
You know, I got to see the toughest white boy I've seen.
Tough. You knock him down, he's going to get right back up. Right up.
He'd fight a bear with a switch.
Well, you tell him I'm tough.
Yes, he's tough.
Go on, tell him I'm tough.
Yes, he's tough.
He came out there, man, and just really got after you, you know. A little guy like that, down on defense.
Bill would guard anybody. And, I mean, he played hard all the time.
I remember we played New Mexico State, and John Williamson, he was one of the toughest guys we'd ever played against. John Williamson had a black eye we were playing, and I remember his eye was closed.
He was about 6'3", big man. He physically just tried to manhandle little Bill, and he was backing down, and we kept seeing little Bill's head just go back like that, you know what I mean? And little Bill would stay on him and stay on him and stay on him.
And he was coming down the floor, he was just elbowing Bill. He hit Bill in the face with an elbow, and Bill just got back up, and me and Keenan looked at ourselves, and we said, he's tough.
That proved to me right then, little Bill had heart.
If you was on that team and you saw the way he played and the way he put out, you'd say, hey, I look that tough.
Keenan Marshall!
Coach Bartow, I thought he was a strict disciplinarian, but I really, when I first started, but I really ended up saying that's a cool old man.
Anybody to meet Gene Bartow has to like Gene Bartow.
He was the kind of coach that anybody would like to have coach their son.
What you see is what you get with Coach Bartow.
Ha! Well, what you see, is what you get, is what you get. What you see,
what you see.
He
loved his job so much that he'd see three guys standing in the corner and Bartow would make a speech to him. This is what he loved, the PR aspect of it. You know, this is what it, you know, we're going to do. We're going to do this. We're going to try to do that. And one day, I think I was interviewing at practice, and he said, you know, if it weren't for those doggone games, this would be the greatest job in the world.
He was the type of guy, your socks had to be right, your uniform had to be tucked in.
We call him Clean Gene, not to his face. But he was pretty straight.
And his idea of really whooping it up after the game was sitting around eating a piece of cake and drinking a cup of hot chocolate.
We were doing something in practice and we was out cussing, you know, and Coach Bartow told us that, now boys, that is atrocious. And we all turned around looking at each other and went, what are you talking about? That's a new word on it. What is atrocious?
And it's funny to be a person that probably didn't say five cuss words since the whole time I was in school. You might think, how could he motivate you? But he did it in his own way, and I think for the most part, guys responded.
Gene could coach. He grew up with the game and was good at it.
Gene Bartow is one of the better coaches in West Proven wherever he's been. He's done very well.
Bartow was the right man in the right place at the right time.
Oh, look, Clean Gene.
The University of Memphis Alumni Association is dedicated to bringing the more than 100,000 alumni of the University of Memphis together.
That's why we sponsor events throughout the year that appeal to all of our fellow alumni. You're invited to dress up for the Distinguished Alumni Awards, wear your Tiger Blue to homecoming events, and celebrate the season at our holiday party.
The Alumni Association also gives you the chance to network with fellow alumni, reestablish ties with classmates, and remain involved with your university.
To join, call 678-2586.
This is knowledge. This is innovation. This is inspiration in action. This is a student body 20,000 strong. And this is why they come. This is the leadership of tomorrow. This is the University of Memphis.
On its own, money is not smart. It needs instruction, guidance, like the kind offered at First Tennessee. Our financial professionals help you straighten out retirement plans, get a loan, plan for college, and get your financial goals in order, so your money has what it takes to wise up and work harder. And that's smart. First Tennessee, all things financial.
In the spring of 1903, Henry Ford made the automobile affordable for everyone. The same holds true today, especially now during Ford's Centennial Celebration Savings Event. Get $3,000 cash back on Ford Expedition, plus returning Ford lessees get an additional $1,500 cash back. That's up to $4,500 cash back on the 2003 Expedition. That's right, the best deal ever on Expedition. Up to $4,500 cash back. See your local Ford dealer today.
This portion of Rightly Seasoned is brought to you by the University of Memphis Alumni Association.
High hopes and undeniable talent wasn't enough to win games early, though. The Tigers struggled, losing three of their first five, including a road game at LSU. Larry Keenan was the first to discover a bad omen.
You're dressing in the dressing room down there, and Keenan discovered he had left his lucky socks. We lost the game. So I don't know if that had anything to do with it or not.
Two games later, another bad sign, as the Tigers dropped a heartbreaker at highly ranked Marquette.
I remember Al McGuire picking his coat off and throwing his coat across the court and hitting the referee getting up and handing it back. And Coach Bartow turned and said, we're not going to win this game.
A rare home loss, this time to the lonely Texas Longhorns, and self-doubt began to set in.
I had never lost three or four games in a row, and it hurt me pretty bad, and I was in the dressing room, I was crying.
I'll never forget as long as I live. Billy Buford cried like a baby. I've never seen a grown man cry as hard as he did.
And I just said, man, we got to do something about this.
If a loss or a game or anything means that much to this particular fellow who I was pretty close to, then surely I can go 100. If I'm doing 105, I can go 110% in order to not let that happen again.
The guys had had enough and called for a players-only meeting behind closed doors.
Yes, sir. We went back in there, we put it all together, and we just got out what we needed to get out.
It was some other movie things here in that closed door meeting among the players.
The coaches wasn't allowed in that meeting at that time.
I don't think you should ever talk about what goes on behind closed doors. But there's, you can imagine how this is how one would go.
Well, you can pretty much forget the eye, and we better go with we or we're going to get killed.
Keenan wasn't going to rule his team. Larry Finch wasn't going to shoot everything. You know, we was going to play every team, and we kind of got that out of there.
We ruffled up some feathers, and after that, everybody accepted the role.
And from then on, looked like this thing just fell into place.
There was an epiphany, I guess you could call it. They just, bingo, okay, here we go.
The closed-door meeting must have worked. The Tigers went on a tear, winning their next 14 games, including a 112-92 thrashing of St. Joseph, where Larry Finch scored a school-record 48 points. While the non-conference wins were important, the league games were critical. In those days, only the conference champion went to the NCAA tournament, and the Missouri Valley was one of the strongest leagues in the nation.
There were some great teams in that Missouri, but my gosh, Bradley and Drake and Wichita State, those guys were tough. They were mean. You had to be tough to go in there and win, and we did.
It was competition every night.
Everybody heard about the Missouri Valley Conference in basketball. It was supposed to have been one of the best basketball conferences in America at the time.
They were good teams. They played good basketball. The fans were vicious on the other end. It was a good conference. I liked it.
Close, hard-fought games down the stretch became routine. The Tigers won 9 contests by 5 points or less. Unlikely heroes helped make it happen. Reserve Jim Liss hit 2 free throws to help knock off Arkansas. And guard Doug McKinney provided excitement in a double overtime thriller.
I can still remember Doug hitting a big basket in the last minute or so, maybe the last few seconds, at Drake one night.
I didn't have any choice. I was in the game, and Finch was supposed to get the ball, and they had him double-teamed. And Keenan was taking the ball out, and Kay had big hands, and he's got the ball like a baseball, and he's looking around. Well, he was running out of time. He fired it to me at half court, and I just took off, and I was probably saying, no, 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 give the ball to Finch, and he let it fly. Luckily, it went in.
So he proved me wrong again.
The league championship was to be decided in, of all places, Las Cruces, New Mexico. New Mexico State played Memphis down to the wire, and the Tigers' tournament hopes this time fell on Westfall's shoulders.
And we're down 1 with a few seconds to play. And in my mind, Wes wasn't a really good, he wasn't a real good shooter. And I'm not sure what he was shooting from the free throw line that year, but probably 60% or so. And he has I believe it was a 1-1, and he looked over at me like, you lousy coach, you know, you think I'm going to miss these. And I just kind of smiled at him, but he hit it, and he looked over again, and then he hit his second one. We won the game by 1. We'd have lost if Wes would have missed those free throws.
The Tigers were Missouri Valley champs and headed to their first dance. And as the rest of the nation would soon find out, they were planning on an early exit.
Left to its own devices, money can get out of control. That's why First Tennessee offers a strict regimen of discipline and guidance, like our priority choices checking. It offers lots of options, free perks, and rewards, so your account can be designed specifically for you. All to keep your money doing the right things, and never out of control. First Tennessee, all things financial.
I'm Charles Burkett, president of First Tennessee Bank.
The 1973 Memphis State basketball team showed an entire community what can happen when people come together and work toward a common goal. I was a student at the university in 1973 and saw firsthand what they were able to become. They motivated us and laid a foundation for great things at the university and in Memphis. On behalf of First Tennessee Bank, I'd like to congratulate the team on its 30th anniversary and thank them for all they did.
In the spring of 1903, Henry Ford made the automobile affordable for everyone. The same holds true today, especially now during Ford's Centennial Celebration Savings Event. Get $3,000 cash back on Ford Expedition, plus returning Ford lessees get an additional $1,500 cash back. That's up to $4,500 cash back on the 2003 Expedition. That's right, the best deal ever on Expedition, up to $4,500 cash back. See your local Ford dealer today.
The University of Memphis Alumni Association brings the more than 100,000 alumni of the U of M together to build relationships, honor faculty, and help prospective students. Each year, the Alumni Association sponsors scholarships and gives awards to professors, researchers, and advisors who make a difference. If you're an alum of the university, please help us by joining the Alumni Association.
Harold calls me every Sunday to see how I'm doing. He's a good son. But Peter calls me every day, so I like Peter better.
With Cellular South's unlimited plan, you get unlimited anytime minutes. Don't wait for nights or weekends. Get the plan that's truly unlimited. Talk as much as you want all day, every day.
Harold takes after his father. Bless his heart.
In the Cellular South, when we say unlimited, we mean unlimited.
This portion of Rightly Seasoned is brought to you by First Tennessee Bank.
Houston, Texas was the site of the Midwest Regional, and thousands of rabid Tiger fans made the trip.
I figured we were on the road, packed with Memphis State people. Packed. Unbelievable. I remember looking off behind our bench, and was nothing but Memphis people.
Then you look over here on this side, you see this sea of blue. You know, Memphis fans, you know, just cheering for you, you know, just cheering you on. That was a thrill within itself, you know.
The night before the big game against South Carolina, the Tigers' first-round opponent, Bartow makes a lineup change. He tells Buford he's in the starting lineup. Westfall is out.
What are you talking about, Coach? He said, well, I'm going to start you tomorrow night.
I could have been bitter about it, which I was very pissed off about it. But I decided we didn't come this far. So that means I was coming off the bench.
I'm a real sentimental person, so I cried again. Kenan's over there going, I'll quit them tears out of your eyes, boy. You know, wake up, man. I knew you was going to be that big dog. We're going to go get him there.
The Tigers jumped on Coach Frank McGuire's heavily favored Gamecocks from the opening tip.
South Carolina, I think, had five of their players who went on to start in the NBA.
Included on the roster were Mike Dunleavy, Brian Winters, and Alex English, but it didn't matter. The Tigers were in command by halftime, a fact that incensed Gamecocks coach Frank McGuire.
I was following Frank, and the officials were in front of him, and Frank was really giving the officials a hard time going up that ramp at halftime. And I told my assistants, I said, well, he'll probably get every call second half the way he's griped at those officials. But second half, we played so great, he could have gotten every call. And we just played a great game that night.
And Larry King was playing at his greatest that particular night.
Keenan stole the show, scoring 34 points while pulling down 20 rebounds, prompting one Louisiana sports writer to mutter, damn, I'd like to see that guy go against Walton. Tigers win 90-76. Next up for Memphis with a Big A champion, Kansas State Wildcats. Led by Lon Kruger, the Wildcats were also heavy favorites. But the Tigers were on a roll. Finch shredded the Cats' zone defense, burning K-State for 32 points.
We played near perfect basketball. Very few turnovers, shot the ball extremely well.
The Tigers found themselves in trouble when Larry Keenan picked up his fourth foul early in the second half, leaving Bartow to look down the bench to his former starter, who had been recently benched.
And Coach looked down the bench at me, and he knew I was kind of salty. And he said, let's go.
Westfall had one of his best games of the season. 10 points on 5 of 6 shooting to go along with 6 rebounds.
A big game for me, you know. I mean, very large game. When I come out that game, I remember Billy Buford hugging me.
Robinson also picked up the slack, scoring 14 points and grabbing 16 boards. The only thing in doubt was the ultimate margin of the Tigers' victory, as Finch put on a dribbling display some say resembled a victory dance.
Larry started to actually dance, dribbling the ball, dancing and all over the court. It was just incredible.
The Tigers had a surprisingly easy 20-point victory, and fans stormed the court to celebrate the moment. One Tiger faithful handed Keenan his lucky stuffed tiger and provided photographer Phyllis Massey with a picture she'll remember for a lifetime.
And very rarely would you see Larry Keenan smile, but he had a smile on his face that day that you just wouldn't believe.
But the celebration was just beginning. At 12:20 a.m. on March 18, 1973, a sleepy Tiger basketball team arrived at Memphis International Airport, and they couldn't believe their bloodshot eyes.
That place was literally people on top of each other.
There were so many people in that building, unbelievable.
Everybody was a Tiger fan. Everybody had blue and gray on, and then, oh boy.
It was a great moment. I'm not sure the airport authority people enjoyed it that much.
Flights can be in or out of Memphis because of the congestion.
I couldn't believe the people that turned out for that. I couldn't believe it.
It doesn't get any more exciting than that, because here we are, for the first time, the Little Memphis State Tigers are going to the Final Four. That is as good as it's ever going to get for anybody in town. It was a tremendously exciting time.
St. Louis, Missouri, gateway to the West, home of the Checker Dome and the 1973 Final Four. Just a short 5-hour trip from Memphis, Tiger fans made it by the busful. But it looked like it might be an even quicker trip home. Providence College was the semifinal opponent, and they were loaded.
That was a heck of a team. They had 3 future NBA players.
Marvin Bad News Barnes, Kevin Stakem, and Ernie DiGregorio were good. Real good. And they knew it.
Yeah, how they looked at us, you know, we warming up. They looked at us rolling their eyes. Oh, man, we're going to get you. You know, we're going to beat y'all. You know, Marvin Barnes jumping out the gym. Oof. Ernie DiGregorio can do anything with the basketball, make it disappear.
Ernie D, yeah, he was, we'd never seen anything like him. And he was, you know, the behind the back passes. Just, you know, an awesome talent.
I had the honor of chasing Ernie D around for about 25 minutes.
To that juncture, I'd never guarded anybody as good as Ernie D. Gregorio was.
He threw some outstanding passes. People didn't do that thing.
I remember Ernie D. Gregorio coming down the court at half court, throwing a ball behind his back that I could not believe he was going to do. And I just watched it. It was unreal. It was unreal.
I can see it as clear as day now that he was coming down the right side of the floor and I was guarding him, and I actually started to reach for the ball out of his right hand and he went behind his back.
I turned my head and I looked back and he's on the ball about by my face.
The perfect strike to, I believe, Kevin Stakem, the forward on that team, for a layup, almost full court pass. It was unbelievable.
I'd never seen that before.
Probably is the greatest pass I've ever seen in a college or NBA game to this day.
Oh, that was exciting. I never seen that. I never seen that come down the floor and go between his legs and look like he's going to do a layup and he eases it off to Marvin Barnes, and Marvin Barnes look like he's going to dunk it and just lay it up. You know, it was beautiful. You know, those guys had so much rhythm.
Providence made the Tigers look foolish most of the first half. If it wasn't a spectacular pass, it was a deadly jumper. Ernie D scored or assisted on 22 of the Friars' first 24 points.
I said, man, how in the world are we going to get out of this?
The Tigers needed a break, and they got one. Marvin Barnes, the nation's second leading rebounder, went down with a twisted knee.
Marvin won out of the game and figured out a way to get out of the game. Act like he twisted his knee.
Believe it or not, I've seen this on the film. Marvin Barnes, lining up along the free throw lane for a foul shot, took a deep knee bend and couldn't get up. He threw his knee out doing a deep knee bend, limps off to the side.
He was at the free throw line, and he came back in the game after he acted like he, I thought he acted like he twisted his knee. And I turned to him, turned to Larry Keenan, and I said, he doesn't want to play, does he? And Keenan said, nah. Lights out, baby.
Even with Marvin Barnes out of the game, Providence was still tough.
Providence led at the half 49-40. But as quickly as Memphis fell behind in the first half, they caught up in the second. Ernie D started to look more like Ernie No D, and the Tigers' big three dominated, combining for 73 points. Keenan and Robinson were brutal on the boards, hauling in 38 rebounds. Memphis crushed Providence in the second half en route to a 98-85 victory. The Bruins were pure Hollywood. Their beautiful campus located in the heart of nearby Pasadena, California. UCLA was a team deep in talent and tradition. They had won 6 straight national titles and 74 games in a row.
You look at a school like that, say they don't want all these championships. I always thought they could be beat.
We didn't know anything about Memphis State. We didn't know anything about anybody. All we knew about was our team, and that was the way Coach Wooden wanted it. And in those days, we were the only team on television. I don't like dynasties. Never have. Who did we play again?
I thought it was Mississippi State. Was it Memphis?
Let's beat these clowns. And that's why I looked at them as clowns. I didn't like them. Never did like them, you know.
Hey, man, we pull this off. Big game like this. Number one team in the nation. Memphis, nobody ever even gave us a chance.
Of course you have concerns. No matter who you're playing, you have to respect every opponent, but fear none. And down deep, I thought we were a better team and we wouldn't overcome. But that doesn't mean that you're going to do that all the time.
You make me nervous now just to even talk about it. I can still remember the night, no sleep.
I couldn't sleep the night before the game. My dad couldn't sleep the night after the game.
Me and Larry just laid there that night. I mean, like, I just wide awake. Hey, man, can you sleep? No. Can you sleep? No. You know, can you believe what's going to happen tomorrow? You know? Well, I mean, what if we win?
In the spring of 1903, Henry Ford made the automobile affordable for everyone. The same holds true today, especially now during Ford's Centennial Celebration Savings Event. Get $3,000 cash back on Ford Expedition, plus returning Ford lessees get an additional $1,500 cash back. That's up to $4,500 cash back on the 2003 Expedition. That's right, the best deal ever on Expedition, up to $4,500 cash back. See your local Ford dealer today.
The University of Memphis Alumni Association is dedicated to bringing the more than 100,000 alumni of the University of Memphis together.
That's why we sponsor events throughout the year that appeal to all of our fellow alumni. You're invited to dress up for the Distinguished Alumni Awards, wear your Tiger Blue to homecoming events, and celebrate the season at our holiday party.
The Alumni Association also gives you the chance to network with fellow alumni, reestablish ties with classmates, and remain involved with your university.
To join, call 678-2586.
No way.
Really? Really?
And the magic number is...
I get Allstate for that.
Say again?
That's my rate.
That can't be right.
Ooh. That sounds great.
Oh, my.
Surprised?
Sweet.
You might be, because qualified drivers can get a company like Allstate for the kind of price you pay with someone else. Maybe even less.
That's for the whole car, right?
That's cool. That's a really good deal.
To see how the right hands make all the difference, just contact Allstate.
Left to its own devices, money can get out of control. That's why First Tennessee offers a strict regimen of discipline and guidance, like our priority choices checking. It offers lots of options, free perks, and rewards, so your account can be designed specifically for you. All to keep your money doing the right things. And never out of control. First Tennessee, all things financial.
Now to Jack Eaton in St. Louis.
Hi, everybody, and welcome to an evening of basketball, the biggest game in the history of Memphis State University.
The pregame excitement in the Checkerdome was electric. The crowd was heavily pro-Memphis. People wanted to see an upset.
Oh, we had a contingent up there.
I believe it seated 19,000 or so. We must have had 18,500 for Memphis State Tigers.
To beat UCLA, most agreed, you had to shut down Big Red.
What are you going to do? Do you have any special plans? How are you going to defend this guy?
We're going to try to force Walton out a little farther and then give him the shot. We feel that half of his game is passing off. We'd like to make a shooter out of him tonight.
Put it out of the air as the tip is pulled down by UCLA.
Bartow's words proved prophetic. From the opening tip, Walton was spectacular.
He hit it!
But even he hadn't seen the likes of Larry Keenan and Larry Finch. Early on, Walton and Keenan traded back.
Keenan for a 15-footer, and Keenan got it. Larry Keenan, down below, drive out of Hollyfield, and the pivot of Walton, he drives around. Keenan puts it up, and he hit it. He spun to his right around Keenan and got a layup.
Yeah, they were back and forth for a minute.
Bill Walton on this end scoring, Larry Keenan on the other end.
Neither one of them could stop each other in the first 6-7 minutes of the game.
I think it just kind of went back and forth, back and forth, back and forth.
The first half was a brilliant display by both teams. Walton scoring on a variety of turnarounds, stick backs, and tip-ins. Memphis countered with jump hooks by Keenan.
Keenan hit it!
And leaning jumpers by Finch.
Down the left side of the lane, goes to baseline, puts up in close. He got it, Finch!
The only sign of trouble in the first half, the Tiger big men were picking up fouls, and a lot of them.
Shot, he hit it, and a foul is caught on Keenan. And the Tigers, my friend, I am sorry to report, are in serious, serious trouble.
The fouls were real quick and tic-tac-y. You know, like, whoa. Well, the referees, I thought, were terrible.
5 minutes into the game, Larry Keenan's got three fouls on him. And he has to go to the bench.
And it really hurt us when we had to take him out.
I was sitting there watching us get in foul trouble, and I'm saying, man, good gracious, we're not going to have anybody left here.
Everybody's in foul trouble pretty quickly.
Keenan, Robinson, and Westfall were all in foul trouble, and UCLA built a 9-point first half lead.
Walton for a big hook shot, a 10-footer from the bucket, and he hit it. Lob out of the bucket of Walton, layup shot, got out of the Tiger zone. This guy's beating us up.
But late in the first half, Walton slapped Buford while going for a block. Earning his third personal foul and a trip to the bench.
Rebound is taken out by Dr. King. First
the Tigers took full advantage, clawing their way back to a halftime tie, much to the delight of the hometown crowd and the hometown announcer.
Finch over the sideline. Larry takes the ball right down the middle. The jumper is 17 foot. He's banked it in. Finch is hit it again. Here's side. And a pivot to Robinson. Baseline jumper 17 feet. Bingo! Robinson got it. Ronnie's second shot. Is it in or not? We're tied at 39.
At halftime, I honestly believe we were going to win that game.
We never had close games like that. That was awesome. That was great.
I think when they went into halftime, they took a deep breath and said, boy, we're in a dogfight here.
They got a little chiding from me at the half.
I don't recall any major adjustment.
More than all, they better get together and play together a little more as a team and have a little more respect for the team that they were playing in the championship game.
Coach Walton didn't even have to talk. It was over. He said some stuff to us. I don't remember what he said.
Before the team took to the court for the second half, Bartow asked if anyone had anything to add. It was the freshman, Bill Cook, who raised his hand.
They were kind of making fun at me right at the end there. Everybody was kind of throwing out suggestions, and I have a speech impediment.
Bill would get excited, and he couldn't talk.
Billy was trying to tell our coach something, and he was having trouble explaining to him.
I was trying to explain if we could sandwich Bill Walton in, put somebody in front of him and put somebody in back of him, and just stop the ball from even going into him. And I got to stuttering.
And Coach was up there on the blackboard, said, "Billy, here." And they were knocking on the door saying, "Coach, you got 1 minute." And Billy and Coach Bartow was up there on the chalkboard, "Here, Billy, here."
And then finally somebody said, "Oh, Bill, just shut up."
And they said, "Come on, Cook, we're supposed to be out on the old floor now. Come on." You know, come on.
We were laughing, went out of the locker room laughing. So, it was great times.
Yeah, evidently, my idea didn't work too well.
This will put the Tigers in the lead. If he hits one of them, tied at 39. Pitcher's free throw, the first of two is airborne.
In the second half, we go ahead 41-39. In other words, in the second half of that game, we had the lead playing for the national championship.
Got it!
The crowd exploded. The mighty UCLA Bruins were on the ropes, and the Tigers appeared to have all the momentum. But a quick whistle tagged Ronnie Robinson with his fourth foul, and the Tigers were forced to go to a zone defense. UCLA point guard Greg Lee began to pick it apart.
In the bucket, under the bucket for the layup shot by Walton. That's good. Lee over it. Lee to Walton underneath. Two.
All of a sudden, about 1 or 2 minutes into the second half, things just started. And it was surreal.
Greg Lee, when our zone shifted either left or right, right as the point of the shift, he would lob that, but it looked like he was taking a shot.
With Wilson's success, forward Keith Wilkes began to get open looks, scoring 12 of his 16 points in the second half.
Nice shot by number 52, Keith Wilkes. Left side out here for Ghost McConnell, in the perimeter back to Shane for a big shot. He misses. Put out a saddle for, and a saddle for a long.
Wilson picked up his fourth foul at the 10-minute mark, and the Tiger players thought it was the break they had been waiting for.
Whoa, 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 whoa. Whoa, whoa.
Dr. Clay gets the
Buford
along the
baseline
for a 16-footer. Billy B. drops it in. Nice shot from the baseline to the right
wing
by 16-footer. Back to
Danvers.
Shane out of
saddle point. But the foul trouble didn't faze Walton. Coach Wooden kept him in the game. And Walton continued his storybook performance, hitting an amazing 21 out of 22 shots from the floor.
I was used to him making 7 straight shots, making 9 straight shots. I was not used to him going 21 for 22. No one anticipated that.
He begs, he puts it up, he hit it!
My dear friend, Mr. Walton, is just incredible.
Under the bucket for the layup shot by Walton, that's good.
Yeah, Walton just had a phenomenal game.
Tigers are lobbed to Walton underneath, and he tipped it in!
Bill was just, seemed like he's in the air the whole game. I never saw his feet touch the floor. You know, it was weird.
Lee way outside. Lob to one underneath. There's two more.
I get far too much credit for this game.
People say about that being such a great game, making 21 out of 22. I said, oh, yeah, you shouldn't have missed that one either.
At a timeout late in the game, Greg Lee posed a question to his legendary coach.
He just said, "Coach, we can't just keep running the same play. Shouldn't we do something different?" And he said,
"Why?"
Okay.
The name broke. Don't fix it.
And we went and ran the exact same play. And guess what? We scored again.
Tigers thought lobbed the wall underneath, and he tipped it in!
I was going through Hong Kong here about 10 years ago, and I was going through Hong Kong Airport. And the guy tells me, a little Chinese guy walks up to me and says, "Hey, I know you. You're the guy that Bill Walton scored 44 points on." So I said, "Okay, all right, you got me."
I hear it all the time myself. You know, "Oh, you played in the NCAA finals against Wallen.
Yeah.
And the guys at home, they with me, man, he gave y'all 44 points. He really killed y'all. And I said, yeah. Yeah, he did.
I got a couple of them that still call me and say, hey, you know, they're going to show you highlights on television. Walton dropping those 44 on you. Yeah, man, okay.
He had a super night, and he still laughs about that night.
Bill Walton is on the floor. Bill Walton is down.
Walton went down late in the game, and Larry Finch said the one thing that I never forgave him for. The one thing that Larry Finch did that really bugged me. He went over and helped Bill Walton off the floor.
He's leaning on Larry Finch's shoulders. He comes out. A great show of sportsmanship by the Tiger players, and Walton is now in pain. He's right in front of me.
I'd have struck him on the eye. But by that time, the game was over. But no, I just... Larry, why are you doing this? Don't you see enemy? For heaven's sakes, don't do that, Vinny. But that's kind of a kid Larry Finch was. I love Larry Finch.
No, well, Larry's that type of guy now. You know, but I wouldn't go help his butt up. I'd have to drop a 40 on him.
I've never forgotten what Larry did. And I knew from that moment on that this guy was first rate. Here we were getting beat for the national championship, and our All-American player was helping their All-American player off the floor. It was a good picture for what college sports are supposed to be all about.
But despite losing their main threat, UCLA scored a flurry of points in the closing minutes, turning what really was a hard-fought struggle into a 21-point rout. UCLA won 87-66. The loss hurt, and the players took it hard.
Well, I lost two sets of contacts because I was crying.
I've never seen a bunch of guys hate to lose as much as that group did.
I won that game worse than I won anything in my life other than my wife.
We would have loved to have been the national champions, but it wasn't in the cards that night, and we lost to a great UCLA team.
It's extremely difficult to lose a championship game because you see your whole life coming apart.
You know you're only going to get this shot one time, and that was our shot.
I reflect back on that game, and I reflect back on our team. We played them two or three times. We beat them.
I really believe that two out of three, we just make them.
I know I'm 49 and bald and have two fused ankles and had 32 operations. And I still like our chance.
Hey, we need to have a rematch. You need to call them back up and say, look, all the old talent at Memphis, we'll play all you old talent at UCLA. And we're going to try to recreate this game, you know.
Well, Walton's on crutches.
Exactly.
I don't want to play without that. That would make a fairly even game, though, with Walton on crutches.
Believe it or not, after 30 years, there are still some people who recognize you, and when they tell you they appreciate you as a player and as a person, it means a lot.
My cousin and I, when we're out, and he has a business, and he introduced, and if I'm with him, he'll say, this is my cousin. He played in the Final Four 30 years ago.
It's meant so much to this program as far as establishing in this city basketball.
I've had a lot of very special teams, great talent, but 72-73, they're definitely number one. It was the greatest highlight of my coaching career.
It was something that I will cherish forever and something I will never forget. It was just a part of my life that stands out probably above a lot of other things that I've done.
Now, I was very happy of having the opportunity to play for a national championship. A lot of people don't get that opportunity. We got it.
What an honor, you know, for a poor guy like me, you know, coming from where I came from.
It was just a magical season, just like very few teams ever experience.
Gosh, I haven't thought about that in a long time. Yeah, that was fun.
brightly seasoned. The 1973 Memphis State Tigers has been brought to you by Ford, First Tennessee Bank, and the University of Memphis Alumni Association.